Good morning, Delton Community Church. I wanted to share with you a quote from Charles Spurgeon that I think captures the theme for this video that I'm about to share, giving a brief update and a spiritual reminder for how we can face these times that we are in. Charles Spurgeon, a pastor in the 19th century and a man very acquainted with suffering, has said that I have learned to kiss the wave that throws me against the rock of ages. That was his view of suffering, that we at this time can either use these as opportunities for despair and to consider how helpless we may be, or we can use these different and trying times to remind us that we are being cast against the rock of ages, the rock that never moves. And Spurgeon well knew, as we should as well, that that rock is the Savior Jesus Christ, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Good morning, Delton Community Church. I just wanted to send a brief update to let you know where we stand as a church, and to also let you know that we are seeking to follow the guidelines that are recommended by the CDC, and to make sure that obviously we're doing our best to keep people safe and healthy. But also, I also wanted to spend some time this morning briefly talking about the hope that we can have. Have your Bibles with you. Maybe if you don't have your Bible there, why don't you go grab that? We're going to be looking at a couple texts here this morning as well. But it was a strange feeling this morning as I walked into our church. And while it is normally an empty building throughout the week, obviously today we normally would be doing youth groups, so the back would be far from empty. It would be full of life and rambunctiousness. But it was unique to think about the fact that this Sunday, this building very likely will be mostly empty. At the very least, we will do some form of streaming worship service for Facebook Live. So it's pretty unique to think of this building as being empty this coming Sunday. And that to me was a pretty strange feeling. It was strange to think that our Sunday school classrooms will be empty, that the fellowship time around the table before our worship service, where we gather around God's Word and share and discuss what Christ has for us in His Word, to think that that wasn't going to be happening this Sunday in its normal setting was unique, to say the least. And so it is a reminder to us, though, and maybe this is cliche, but it's true, but it's a reminder to us that the church obviously is not the building. The building is where we have gathered and where it makes sense for us to gather, to have a place to meet and to prepare and to really to then disperse. And that thought hit me this morning as I was getting mail from our post office box. I opened up, I put the key in the door, I opened up the post office box and pulled our mail out, and then I shut the door to the empty post office box. And as I put my key into the church door this morning and opened it up and saw that it too was empty, it was a reminder to me that the church is not closed. The church is not inactive. And in fact, as we talked about last Sunday, we have an opportunity to really love our neighbors well and to show the love of Christ and to do so by also sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, and that we back that message up. We truly authenticate that message by loving our neighbors well and loving them as we already love ourselves. So just as mail is pointless sitting in a post office box, so too as a Christian, if we were to see the church as the only opportunity to demonstrate our faith. So dear brothers and sisters of Delton Community Church, and those also fellow saints of the God on high who has won us and bought us by the precious blood of Christ, the church building may be closed and may be moderately empty, but the church is alive and active because our God is alive and active. The same God who has sent you on His great commissioning to go into all the world is the God who is with you. And that is one of the great promises of that Matthew 28 commissioning, that Jesus Christ is with us even into the end of the age. I did also want to spend just a little bit of time looking at talking in large, and so not in super great microscopic detail, but about the book of Job. As we consider what's going on in our world today, we often can get the mindset of what is God doing through this, and how should we as followers of Christ be responding to this? And those thoughts have led me to look at the book of Job in a slightly more closely applicable light, if that makes any sense at all. And if you're familiar with the grand narrative of Job, we know that Job began his appearance into the book that bears his name under great dire circumstances. We know that God had allowed Satan to tempt and to truly to put Job's faith to the test, because God knew that Job was faithful. And God knew that Job was faithful because Job knows that God is faithful. But God had allowed Satan to test Job to tempt Job in certain ways. He allowed Satan to take his children's life. So Job had seen and had lived through the fact that his children had died. That, to me, would be remarkably painful. Words probably fail to even comprehend what Job was feeling at that time. Job wasn't emotionless during this time. Job had emotions. Job had what I hope we'll see is Godward emotions. In fact, chapter 1, following the death of his children, it is recorded that Job responded in this way in verse 20. Then Job arose and tore his robe and shaved his head and fell on the ground and worshipped. And he said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. The testing would continue for Job. Job was allowed to undergo further testing, we could say, as Satan's attack on Job also then came towards his health. Job was covered with sores. He was utterly racked by his scratching and itching. And Job 2, verse 7 reads, "So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and struck Job with loathsome sores, and from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. And he took a piece of broken pottery with which to scrape himself while he sat in the ashes. Then his wife said to him, 'Do you still hold fast your integrity? Curse God and die.' But he," Job, "said to her, 'You speak as one of the foolish women would speak. Shall we receive good from God, and shall we not receive evil? In all this, Job did not sin with his lips." You have Job experiencing profound suffering of untold levels, again, that many of us will likely never experience to the full extent that Job did. And in the beginning of his suffering, as the initial experience of his suffering was going on, he did not sin. He did not accuse God. He kept his attitude and his emotions Godward while not being absent of his reality. He was still obviously suffering. We know that for the next number of chapters, Job had some advisors. He had three friends that came, and throughout this time, we've got these advisors really offering Job some half-truths. We have them basically saying that, well, Job, maybe you have some sin of some form that is unrepented of, and that maybe God is judging you for that. And we see that throughout these chapters, as chapters 3 and honestly on through about 12 and 13 continue, Job actually still maintains a full and nearly complete grasp on the faith that he demonstrates in chapters 1 and 2. Chapter 13, Job continues in his response, and the ESV actually gives the paragraph or the chapter the heading, "Still I wait and I will hope in the Lord." But we start to see a slight wavering in Job's confidence. He begins actually to talk about how he's waiting on the Lord, but he's also talking about the fact that he wants to argue his case with God. He says in 13:23, "How many are my iniquities and my sins? Make me know my transgressions and my sin," which isn't a bad thought. But in verse 24, he then says, "Why do you hide your face and count me as your enemy?" And we know that God has not done this. So we know that the counsel of Job's friends is starting to, the half-truths that they're sharing with him are starting to have their sad impact. But we also know that this does not last for the entirety of Job's experience. And Job goes back and forth with his advisors, with his friends. But then in Job 19, we know that his eternal hope is not shaken. We know that while he has walked through incredibly painful times, he has not lost the eternal hope that God has offered him, even in this pre-Christ's life experience. Even in that, Job is knowing that he has a Redeemer. And he knows that even if this situation that God has allowed to befall him, this didn't happen, Job's experiences did not happen apart from God's providential and sovereign hand, even if it were to take his life, Job knows that his Redeemer lives. He says as much in 19:25. In Job 19, verse 25, it begins, "For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, yet in my flesh I shall see my God, whom I shall see for myself. My eyes shall behold and not another. My heart faints within me." His immediate circumstances have certainly affected him. They've affected even his thinking, but as he thinks even soberly about his eternity and the fact that even if these circumstances were to take his life, he knows that his Redeemer lives. I believe that is incredibly instructive for us this morning, this week, in the coming months, and whatever the future holds for either one of us. So Job has these experiences where the counsel, the half-truths of his friends, it has its impact on him, but then he also reminds himself of those eternal truths. This goes on, this carries on. In fact, we start to see Job maybe slightly waver again. In chapter 23, Job says, "Then Job answered his friends," and he says, verse 2, "Today my complaint is bitter. My hand is heavy on account of my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him," speaking of God, "that I might come even to his seat. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would know that he would answer me and understand what he would say to me." A little bit of waffling back and forth. Verse 6, "Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, he would pay attention to me. Then an upright man could argue with me, and I would be acquitted forever by my judge." So we see a little bit of back and forth there in Job's understanding of what's going on with his circumstances and his suffering. I'm thankful that in verse 32, Job has a younger friend who has withheld his speaking by the name of Elihu. And in chapters 32 through 37, Elihu speaks, and he actually rebukes Job for some of his waffling, and rightly so. In chapter 33, verses 6 through 7, we see Elihu speak, who speaks to Job, actually, and in his rebuke, I'll begin in verse 5, "Answer me if you can," this is Elihu speaking, "set your words in order before me, take your stand. Behold, I am toward God as you are. I, too, was pinched off from a piece of clay. Behold, no fear of me terrify you. My pressure will not be heavy upon you." So Elihu warns Job, "I'm going to rebuke you, but I, too, am just clay." And then in verses 9 through 11, he actually questions Job. He says, "You say I am pure without transgression. I am clean, and there is no iniquity in me. Behold, he finds occasion against me. He counts me as his enemy. He puts my feet in the stocks and watches all my paths," quoting Job's complaint against God. And then Elihu says, verse 12, "Behold, in this you are not right. I will answer you, for God is greater than men. Man, why do you contend against him, saying, he will answer none of man's words?" So he reminds Job that you aren't sinless. You're righteous, certainly. You have a level of righteousness that is certainly commendable, that we know is a gift from God as we see through the lens of the New Testament, but he is not perfectly sinless. Elihu goes on to then even rebuke Job's pride in chapter 37. In chapter 37, begin in verse 14, we see here Elihu say, and he's proclaiming all of, well, not all of, but many of God's attributes, one of them being God's majesty, and in contending for God's majesty, in verse 14, Elihu says, "Hear this, O Job. Stop and consider the wondrous works of God. Do you know how God lays his command upon them and causes the lightning of his cloud to shine? Do you know the balancings of the clouds, the wondrous works of him who is perfect in knowledge? You whose garments are hot when the earth is still because of the south wind. Can you, like him, spread out the skies hard as a cast metal mirror? Teach us what we shall say to him. We cannot draw up our case because of darkness. Shall it be told him that I would speak? Did a man ever wish that he would be swallowed up? And now no one looks on the light when it is bright in the skies, when the wind has passed and cleared them. Out of the north comes golden splendor. God is clothed with awesome majesty. The Almighty, we cannot find him. He is great in power. Justice and abundant righteousness he will not violate. Therefore men fear him. He does not regard any who are wise in their own conceit." Elihu rightly rebukes Job, and we can see in this that Job's sufferings are not meant as punishment. That God had two purposes, at least, in allowing Job to experience the tragic circumstances that he did experience. And one was to demonstrate to Satan that Job's faithfulness in God and his trust in God could not be altered by the earthly circumstances. I wonder how well that message resonates with us today. But additionally, we also see that even in Elihu's counsel to Job, that God was also using those sufferings as the refiner's fire. We know that the suffering that Job experienced was not punishment for his sins. God isn't in the business of double jeopardy. One will either pay for their consequences, will pay justice, have justice served for their sins for an eternity in hell, or, thanks be to God, they will be paid for on the cross of Christ as Jesus absorbs the wrath of our sins, the wrath that our sins has deserved. So we know that Job, trusting in that future Redeemer that he would see in his flesh, trusting in that future Redeemer that we now know as Jesus Christ in the full revelation of God's canon of Scripture, that Job wasn't suffering as a punishment for his sins. But these sufferings were also used by God in a mighty way to refine Job's pride, to refine maybe even his own overestimation of his righteousness. And Elihu's rebuke allows that, but the Lord also says nearly as much. Because as Job closes in the final chapters, 38 and through the close, Job hears God directly speak to him out of the whirlwind. 38, verse 2, "Who is this that darkness that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Dress for action like a man. I will question you, and you make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched out the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy? Or who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band and prescribed limits for it and set bars and doors and said, thus far shall you come and no farther, and here shall your proud waves be stayed." God reminds Job of his awesome power, his providential hand over all of creation, from the microscopic to the grand stars and seas of even our own planet. So chapter 38 speaks to that. And Job finally has a slight answer in chapter 40 and promises silence. "Behold," Job says in Job 40 verse 4, "behold, I am of small account. What shall I answer you? I lay my hand on my mouth. I have spoken once, and I will not answer twice. But I will proceed no further. I know my limits, God." And so God then challenges him to dress for action and to further him with that command and description of Behemoth and Leviathan. Job then in chapter 42 answers the Lord and says, I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I did not understand. Elihu's rebuke and Job's hearing the Lord tell him who he is and how powerful he is has had its impact. Job understands that he has spoken without understanding. And he says then, therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. The Lord Jesus had similar warnings for the people of his day when the Tower of Siloam fell. And he says, repent, lest you likewise perish. So while we don't know precisely what God is doing in all of the different ways that this virus is impacting our world and our lives, we do know that the message of repent and trust, the very first words that are recorded from Jesus' earthly ministry in the Gospel of Mark, repent and trust for the gospel, the kingdom of God is at hand, are still alive and active. And as disciples of Christ, we have the opportunity to share that. And 1 Peter speaks a lot of suffering, and just like Job needed to be reminded of his own overconfidence, we too should also be reminded of the fact that these sufferings are not happening apart from God's sovereign hand. 1 Peter 1 verse 3 begins, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. God has power over death. To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. Think of that as we think of the transitory nature of where we place our confidence on earth, that our inheritance in heaven is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. Verse 5, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials. Verse 7, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, and may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So we know that these times can be used to refine our faith, to strip away from us maybe the things that we are trusting in, that we add to our trust in Jesus Christ, because it's in him we have hope, and in hope alone. I'll close with just a suggested reading for these anxious times. John chapter 14, Jesus is preparing his disciples for his eventual physical absence from them. As he was preparing them for his death, his sin-atoning death, his wrath-absorbing death, his justice-accomplishing death, his resurrection guaranteeing death and then resurrection, he reminds them of the sureness of the fact that he is going to prepare a place for us. And so my suggestion over these coming days and weeks to look at John 14, 15, 16, even into John 17, and see in that how God combats our anxiousness, how he has given us the Holy Spirit to remind us of what Jesus has taught us, to convict us of sin, to remind us of righteousness and judgment, but also to not give us that spirit of fear so that we stand in the sure hope of Jesus Christ even when all things around us seem to be in upheaval. So while the church will be gathering in different ways, while our building may remain empty for a certain amount of time, and as your board, I ask you to pray for your board as we continue to think of ways that we can still gather, whether physically or spiritually, and to be also honoring the restrictions placed upon us. I ask you to be in prayer, to be fervent in prayer. Pray for those affected by the sickness. Pray that God would heal them in his mercy, which is abundant. Pray for your board. Pray for me that we all can make decisions regarding our church that best serve his gospel and his ministry that he is using even these times to accomplish. Be a good neighbor. love your neighbors as yourself. Reach out to them, yes, with tangible helps of mercy and reaching out to them, helping maybe the elderly or those that are sick and recovering from diseases and illnesses, to shop, doing those common sense things, but accompanying those with the saving knowledge, the saving mercy, the saving message of Jesus Christ, so that we know that our firm hope is not shaken when all around us is thrown in upheaval, that we can, like Job, see that even though our world systems are shaken, that the foundation that Christ has established is not. It remains unshaken, unmoved, firm in all storms of life. So, dear friends, may we, with the confidence of the God that has rescued us, the confidence that the cross that we often face in worship is empty, the confidence that the tomb that we consider in our minds on Easter morning is empty, we know that his promises are not, and they stand firm. So go in the peace of Christ this morning, the rest of today, whenever you've watched this video, and just watch your email inboxes for different ways that we can continue to be the church, even though the doors are shut, the lights, except for a few, are off. We have opportunities to truly be that gospel hope and to be spread and dispersed, much like the mail that is no longer in our mailboxes. Go and serve the Lord in peace and love and mercy and sharing his saving message of faith in Jesus Christ. Amen.